Good morning, y'all. Let's all stand up and let's praise this morning.
Glad to be in the house of the Lord. Somebody say amen. Man, ain't God good to us. You can be seated right where you are. Thank you so much for being here this morning at New Journey Church. We are so grateful that you are in this place. Listen, if this is your very first time here today with us, we want you to know that we love you. We're thankful that you're here, and we appreciate you. Church, don't we appreciate our first-time guests? Give them a hand of love. And listen, there's a card in the chair in front of you that we would love for you to take out and fill out. But listen, you can put as much or as little information on that card as you want to. I promise you, we're not going to come beat down your door. We're not going to blow up your email. We're not going to do any of those things. But the one most important thing on that card, if you would do us just a huge favor, take that card out, flip it over on the back side. On the bottom of that card, there's a place that says prayer request. Would you please write down the one thing that you need God to do in your life this year? It would be our honor and our pleasure to take your need before the throne this week and pray for you, pray with you, and ask God for the needs that are in your life. Let us do that for you. So we ask you this morning, if this is your first time, let that be your gift to us. Take that card, fill it out. And like I say, you can put as much or as little information as you're comfortable with putting on there. That's fine. But at least give us your prayer request, the one thing that you need God to do in your life. We want to be praying with you. At the end of the service, my wife and I will be right back there. And we would love to meet you, shake your hand, and just tell you thank you personally for being here today. Church, one more time, give our first-time guests a hand of love. Thank you so much for being here. And listen, if you're online with us this morning, we want to let you know that we appreciate you being here with us week in and week out. We have several that gather with us online every single week. And we have even more that come on and watch our service either later during the day or later on during the week. And we just want to thank you for being a part of our online campus. And we have somebody right now that wants to chat with you. They want to pray with you. And they're online with you right now. That's their sole responsibility. So while you're there, make sure you chat with us and make sure that you spend time with them. If you would like to connect with us, we would love to connect with you. You can fill out a connect card right there online, or you can pray with somebody in a private chat room with them. So take advantage of those opportunities that are online with you. Church, don't we appreciate our online guests as well? Thank you so much. I got just a couple of announcements. Actually, we have a bunch of announcements, but I'm going to try to work my way through them pretty quickly. So off the top, volunteers of the week. I just want to go ahead and get this out of the way. Chris and Missy. How many of y'all love Chris and Missy? Man. I can't say enough good things about them. There is not anything that we ever venture to do as a church. That at least one of them, if not both of them, are involved, and they don't look to be in that. They don't look to be in the spotlight. They don't want to be on stage. They don't even want people to know that they're the ones doing things. But they are always constant in being there and doing whatever needs to happen. And I just appreciate y'all. You have no idea how much I appreciate you guys being a part of New Journey Church. And how much more I wish we had more people that were just exactly like you. They don't look for the credit. They're more than willing to do the things that nobody else wants to do. If somebody needs to sweep something, hey, they'll sweep it. If somebody needs to do the hard work, man, they'll do it. And they're happy to do that. Man, I'm so excited. Thank you so much. But I'm going to tell you, I don't know that this place would still be here today if it hadn't been for them being a part of our church for as many years as they have. Thank you so much for all that you do. And if they can't get it done, I promise you, they can bring an army of people to make it happen. So we appreciate them greatly. Also, one thing I want to put in your ear, and I want you to hear me when I say this. Square One, if you look in your bulletin on the front inside cover, Square One is a tremendous, tremendous opportunity. So if you're wanting to know more about our church, if you're wanting to get involved in our church in some way, if you're wanting to connect, or if you're just wanting to know why we do what we do, but you're not really sure if you want to connect, that's fine. This is a non-pressure situation. You can come, you can find out about who we are, what we stand on, what we believe, where we're going. And if you want to connect, this is a great place to connect. We can get you connected to a small group. We get you connected to a serving team, getting involved, volunteering, those kind of things. You can do all those things right here through Square One. Or like I say, if you just want to know a little bit more about who we are. But I need you to register. We're going to serve you lunch. So I need you to go on here, take this QR code, take your phone, scan the QR code, register to be there. Because if you do not register, we will not feed you. Somebody say amen. Amen. All right. The only way we're going to know that you're going to be there and we're going to plan on having food for you is if you register. So make sure that you register. We're going to do this. It's December the 3rd. So it's next Sunday. So right after the service, you don't have to plan on going anywhere, going and buying lunch or doing all that. You can just hang out right here for a few minutes after the service. We're going to have lunch come in to you, and we're going to take some time and just share a little bit about who we are and how you can get connected here at New Journey Church. Amen? Amen. Also, coming up December the 17th, we have our third annual Really Chilly Christmas Carol. Somebody say amen. Now, for those of you that have no idea what that is, you will walk in here that Sunday morning and this place will not look the same. All right, we are going to have tables set up and we're going to have rows and rows and rows and rows and rows of chili. And people say, chili? For Christmas? Absolutely. We're going to have a time, and we've had a blast. The last couple times we have done this, it has been absolutely incredible. We want you to wear your ugliest Christmas sweater because we're going to have an ugly Christmas sweater contest that morning. This is not a night thing. This is a Sunday morning. This is how we do our Christmas Sunday mornings. We're going to do that on the 17th this year. We'll not have a scheduled service the next week. We won't do service next week. People will be doing things with their family. We want you to have family time and go spend time with your family. But on the 17th, we're going to come in here and we are going to absolutely have a time. So we've got a chili cook-off. If you want to enter your best chili into that chili cook-off, we will have a contest and a winner for the chili cook-off. So we need you to sign up back there and plan on coming, bringing chili with you. And then we've got several different things. Our worship team will be doing a Christmas concert, so we'll be doing Christmas songs. And then also, we might just have Santa. Maybe. Might just have Santa come in. So we've got, I'm telling you, it is absolutely, absolutely a blast. We're going to have some door prizes. You won't have to worry about lunch because you're going to be eating chili. And now I can't help what happens when you get home. But we're going to have a good time while we're here. Amen. So plan on coming, being a part of that. It's going to absolutely be a tremendous, tremendous day. So Operation Grinchmas. Operation Grinchmas is a ministry to offer cheer to those who have chosen to enter recovery. Please help give the gift of joy and an I care this season. Several different needs. We have our toiletries, wrap candy, individual sock, snacks, stocking stuffers, monetary donations, how to give. There's a basket in the corridor. We're actually not going to call it a corridor. We're going to call it the foyer out there to where you can give a donation. So if you don't mind, next Sunday when you come, bring all that you can bring. And we're going to do that and try to be a help to our community. Somebody say amen right there. Also, I know we're running long. We have a church budget meeting. Do you want to handle all that here? Okay, I'm going to let you handle that. Okay, right after the service today, I mean right after, and it's not going to take 5 minutes. I promise we will not hold you long. 5 minutes, right after the service, come up here to the stage. Any of you that want to help us do some work in the church, we need people that can swing hammers, that can run power tools. We need people that can sweep, that can all those things. If whatever you can do, we need you to do it. So we're going to be trying to finish out our Chest of Joash build out. So our extended foyer back there, we're going to be, you know, installing the center wall there, the new sound booth, the coffee cafe, building out the bar and all of that. Man, it's just going to be tremendous. So we need to know who wants to help us with that build out. If you want to help out, we would like to meet you right down here right after service just for, like I say, for about 5 minutes. Just need to see who's available, when you're available, and if you want to help. So come and be a part of that this morning. Amen? Amen. All right, brother.
Well, happy National Leftover Day after Thanksgiving. Who's having turkey for Sunday afternoon dinner? Yeah. Turkey sandwiches, there you go. All right, so David spoke about the Chest of Joash. So a couple of weeks ago, we were about $12,000 short. Right now, we are within about $5,200 of making our goal for this year for the Chest of Joash. So all the things, there's a, on the back table in the foyer, there's a piece of paper that has our Chest of Joash giving. So we're about $5,200 less or more that we need. And there's also, there's two sections to it, what we have done in the top and what we want to do in the bottom. So that's part of the build-out David was talking about. There are probably, I would bet the $5,200 is maybe people that don't go to church here anymore, maybe something happened that somebody couldn't give. But maybe God has done something for you that you can pick up some slack. You realize we have five Sundays left in this year, including today, not including Christmas. There are five Sundays left. That's only $1,000 a Sunday. That's very doable. Let's see if we can make up our $5,200 and get the chest of Joash full like it's supposed to be. The other thing is, on the same table, there is next year's budget. So it's what we budget for next year. We have our meeting, our budget meeting is next Sunday at 4 o'clock. If you want to come have any questions about the budget, take it home, look over it. It's just ties what we need, what our expenses are. It looks like this year's budget is about 12% more than last year. I think that turned out pretty well because we're not doing a whole lot more, but we're not having to spend a whole lot more. Everybody knows the price of eggs and milk and power and everything else went up. If we're only going up 12%, I think we're being very frugal with our money. So be sure to get one or both of those pieces of paper in the back. And next week, 4 o'clock, it'll be our church budget meeting. All right? We just went through the Thanksgiving season. Some of us are still going through it this afternoon with leftovers. But did you think, Tammy did something at our Christmas Thanksgiving. And it was, I think I'm going to get this right. Back when the pilgrims first came to America, you know, they had the winter and they were about to starve to death and a lot of them died and all that. Well, they would actually ration out kernels of corn and everybody got five. You could do with those five whatever you wanted, but that's all you got. Then the spring came and they planted the seeds and they got more of a bounty of increase. And that's what giving does for us. We plant a little bit and God gives us a lot. So no matter how small your blessing is, the fruit of it can be huge. That's what giving does for us. Whatever we give, God multiplies. Pressed down, shaken together, running over. And that's how we get more people into God's hands and into the family of God. Let's take our offering and let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this season. Lord, we thank you for the people in this audience. Lord, bless this offering. Use it for your honor and glory. May every dime that we collect go to spread the word and the gospel of Jesus Christ. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go, but I see it now. I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I'm running to
to the dark, blessed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, a 100 million galaxies are born. In the vapor of your breath, the planet is born. The stars
y'all realize God made all of it, all of us. Everything you see, he made, and it is perfect. And it all works in perfect harmony together. There's only one way stuff like that can happen, and that's because of God.
Stars were made to worship, so will I. If the mountains bow in reverence, so will I. If the oceans roar in greatness, so will I. For if everything exists to lift you high, so will I.
Well, awesome. Man, awesome, awesome job. Go ahead and open up your Bible, turn to the book of Matthew, chapter number 1. And we're going to jump in a week early into our December series. So, I'm sorry, but just hang with me. Oh my goodness, are you serious? Another Christmas series at Christmas time. Yeah, but we're going to approach things a little bit differently this year. I want to talk about, over the course of the next few weeks, I want to talk about life-changing moments. I want to ask you, number one, has anybody in here ever had a life-changing moment? Now, one, if you've ever been saved by the grace of God, you've had a life-changing moment. Honey, if you believe that you got saved and it wasn't life-changing, can I tell you, you're not saved. You didn't get the goods. You didn't get what He had for you. I promise you, if your life has not changed since He saved you, you did not get saved. Now, you may have said a prayer. Oh, y'all need to listen to me now. You may have said a prayer. You may have even been baptized. Somebody put a little water on you. Somebody signed their name in the front of your Bible. None of those things mean salvation. Salvation is surrendering your life to Christ and saying, "Oh God, I'm a mess. I'm a wreck. I'm a sinner. I realize that I'm a sinner. I am lost and undone without You." And realizing the things that you are saying are not just coming from your mouth, but they're coming from your soul, from your heart. And you're crying out to God because you realize that you are lost and headed for hell. When you have that kind of mindset and you're calling out on God, the Bible says that God will save you. He said, "If you call on Me, I'll save you." But honey, if you think you just did this little mental thing, where you're like, "Oh yeah, you know, I believe in God. I'll say a little prayer. Oh yeah, I'll get in the baptism pool." That's not salvation. I don't ever want you to walk away from this place thinking that it is. Salvation is life-changing. And if it is not changing your life, you did not get it. Amen. 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 So I want to start this series with a simple little idea. I want to kind of approach this a little bit differently. And I want to take the next few weeks to try to unpack this idea with you. Okay? I want you to go on this journey with me. And who knows? It might even change the way you live. Here it is. Are you ready? Life is not measured in time. I know all of us go, "But wait, I got this thing right here on my wrist. And even have it on this thing right here. I can pull this out, and as soon as I pull it out, wow, look at there. There's the time. It just jumps right out at me." Matter of fact, let me go ahead and put these on silent. For some reason, I didn't do that. That might be a problem here in a little bit. But life is not measured in time. We think life is measured in time because we have, you know, we have days and we have weeks and we have months and years and we have 24 hours in a day, right? 60 minutes in an hour, right? I mean, you go on and on and on. And that's, we have become accustomed to our life being run by time. And I'm not against you being on time. Somebody say amen right there. Anybody that has responsibilities in the house, say amen right there. Anybody that has other people in their life that has responsibilities that don't show up on time, say amen right there. Time is important. I'm not saying time is not important, and I'm not saying that being on time is not important. However, life is not measured in time. Listen to me. Life is measured in moments. Life is measured in moments. Now, I believe that this is absolutely generally true, okay? I believe life is measured in moments, because I want you to think about this. Rarely do we ever remember an entire year. Does anybody in here have a particular year that they remember every second of the day, every week, every month of that year? No, you don't. No. Matter of fact, let's break it on down a little bit. I bet you don't even have a month that you can remember the entire month. I bet there's not even a week that you can remember every single detail about every second of that week. Here's the crazy thing. I bet you can't even remember a day. A day where you can remember every single thing about every second of that day. But you know what you do remember? Moments. You remember moments, right? We do remember when we got that phone call. We do remember what happened on our job when somebody got hurt, or that we lost a job, or that we got a job. We do remember whenever the news hit and all across the world was shook because of a moment. I know exactly where I was at 9/11. Exactly where I was at. Exactly what I was doing. I'll never forget that. It's a moment. We can remember when children are born. Because it wasn't about the time, it was about the moment. We can remember when parents or grandparents pass. Or even worse yet, when a brother or sister or child. Because that's not time. It's a moment. It may be a moment in time, but it's a moment. So I want us to look at the life. I want us to look at some life-changing moments that took place surrounding the birth of Christ. And today I want us to look at, a very powerful life-changing moment of obedience. I want us to look today at obedience. And if I could get you to remember one thing, I'm going to go ahead and give you the punchline for the day. I'm going to go ahead and give it to you right up front. That way, if you decide that this is getting a little too long, you'll already have it. Right? You'll still remember it. I'm going to pray that God would burn this in your brain even now. So if you don't like what I'm preaching 10 minutes from now and leave, you'll still have to deal with it. Listen to me. You have no idea what God can do through one moment of obedience. I'm going to say that again. You have no idea what God can do through one simple moment of obedience. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together. God, in this building, we thank you, Lord, that we can come together as a body, as the church. God, we thank you that we can come together, that we can worship you, that we can glorify you. God, thank you so much that we had an opportunity to lift our voices together in praise and in worship. And God, now I pray that you would attune our ears to your word. Father, I pray that you'd open our hearts. God, I pray that we would have eyes to see and ears to hear. God, I pray that you'd give us understanding, and I pray that you'd give us wisdom. God, I pray that we would not walk away from this place and from this word today without applying it to our life. Help us not to just be hearers of the word, but doers of the word. Father, I pray that none of my philosophy, none of my theology, none of my belief system infects or affects this message or these people. But God, I pray your word, God, would be planted deep in our hearts so we might not sin against you, that we might live for you and love you and have life change because of it. Lord, we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So let me ask you a question. Have you ever been prompted to say something or give something or do something and you did it? Like you felt like, man, I feel like that the Lord is prompting me to do this or to say this or maybe to give this. Anybody in here ever had that happen and you did it? Man, the feeling that took place after you obeyed and you did the thing that might even been crazy at the time, but it was the thing that you knew God had put on your heart to do and you did it, and it was just like, wow, this overwhelming, this moment that you're in is now all of a sudden it's overwhelming, it's exciting, man, you look back at it and you're just like, wow, this is just absolutely incredible. Look at what God did just through an act of obedience. I didn't have anything to do about it. I knew that it was a God moment. I knew that God was doing something. I didn't have anything. All I did was I was just obedient in the moment. I just said the thing that God told me to say, or I just did the thing that God told me to do, or I just gave the thing that God told me to give. And through that one simple act of obedience, God did something tremendous, right? Well, I wonder how many of you have probably, maybe you've been prompted to do something or to say something or to give something and you didn't do it. How many's done that? I have. And then you have this regret. And it's like, man, I know I should have done that, or I should have gave that, or I should have said that. And now you have this regret, and you have this, you know, you wonder what kind of blessing I missed because I didn't do the thing that God said to do in my life. So, so what we do, or what do we do when it's not easy to obey? How many of you know that there are some circumstances in life, it's just not easy to obey God? It's just not easy to do the thing that God says to do, right? I mean, we read it in His Word. Okay, God says do this. He says don't do that. And it's like, you know, man, I really want to live by what God wants me to live by. But, man, this is a really difficult situation, and I believe that God would want me to do this, but that's not what I want to do. Or that's not what people around me are expecting me to do. And it makes it very difficult to live for Christ and to do the thing that He's prompted you to do, or to say the thing that He's prompted you to say, or to give the thing that He's prompted you to give. Look at Matthew chapter number 1. Matthew chapter number 1. And I want to start at verse number 18. Matthew chapter number 1. Verse number 18, and it says this. It says, now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After His mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Now, you're probably familiar with Mary, right? Mary, the mother of Jesus. She gets a lot of stage time in churches. Right, people just, we just kind of know who she is, right? They talked a lot about her, especially this time of year. You know, she just gets a lot of airtime, right? But today, I really want to talk about Joseph. And he's one of the most important people, but the least talked about people, characters in Scripture. So I want to talk about him just a little bit today. So the Bible describes Joseph. The Bible describes Joseph as a carpenter. It describes him as a righteous man. It describes him as a faithful man. It describes him as a descendant of King David. It describes him as Mary's husband. And it also describes him as Jesus' earthly father figure. So we see Joseph in the life of Christ, in the early life of Christ. Right? The last time that we even see Joseph there or mentioned is when Jesus is about 12 years old. Right? That's when he was still at the temple and he was in there teaching, and they were all astonished, and they lost him. They thought he was with them, but then they realized he wasn't with them. I wonder how many of us sometimes think Jesus is with us, and we're looking around while we're doing our plans, and then we all of a sudden go, oh, wow, Jesus ain't nowhere near here. See, I had been running around saying, this is what I'm going to do for God, this is what I'm going to do for God, this is what I'm going to do for God, this is what I'm going to do for God. And then I realized, oh, wait, where is God? You didn't even consult Him about what you were going to do for God. You just started saying, this is what I'm going to do for God. And God may not want you to do that for Him at all. He may want you to do something else for Him. Oh. Most scholars assume that somewhere after that 12-year-old period of Jesus that Joseph probably died. And the reason why they assume that is because Jesus stayed home until he was 30 years old. That's not to encourage young adults to stay home and play video games until they're 30 years old. Mamas and daddies say amen. But Jesus stayed there until he was 30 years old, most likely because he was taking care of his mom and he was providing for the home at a young age. It's probably what took place. But as he got to 30 years old, it was time for his public ministry to begin. And so he stepped out and did that. And also we find out at the cross, when Christ is hanging on the cross before he passes away, before he dies, he says to John, remember he says to the Apostle John, he said, hey, take care of my mom, right? Take care of Mary. Look after her. Watch after her. Take care of her. Now, if Joseph would have still been there, there wouldn't have really been a reason for him to say that, right? So most scholars assume that he passed away when Jesus was a little bit younger. But Joseph was engaged to Mary. They were engaged, okay? And who was supposed to be a virgin, right? When she tells Joseph that she's pregnant. Now, I want you to think about this. Imagine that you are engaged, or imagine, you know, your spouse that you have now. Imagine you've been engaged, and man, you're excited about getting married and all these things, and then all of a sudden, your spouse comes up and says, I'm pregnant. And you know that you know that you know that you know that it is not by you. This is devastating. This is horrifying. Do you understand? This isn't like an engagement in today's time, where if that happened, people would be like, well, you know, we see it happen all the time. This is first century Jewish engagement, all right? This wasn't just a proposal on Instagram, all right? This wasn't just an Instagram moment. You understand? This was a formal agreement between families. They were technically already married. Right? In other words, the paperwork's done. Like it's already there. They're just waiting on the ceremony to take place. So they could not be together intimately until that took place. And she walks up and says, so I got something I need to tell you. Listen, if Mary had sex with another man, that would have been life ruining. Not only for her, but for him. Think about it. That would mean that she disobeyed God, which, believe it or not, in that time was a big deal. It would have meant that she dishonored her family. Probably would be disowned by her family. And then also disgracing Joseph, her soon-to-be husband. And according to Deuteronomy 22, she could have been stoned. Joseph could have walked her out there in the public square and said, this is what she has done. The elders would have came, and every one of them would have picked up stones, and they would have killed her right there on the spot. And he could have done that. He had legal right to be able to. But Joseph really was a good guy. He was just a good guy. You know any good guys? It's like, you know, this guy's like, man, you know, yeah, he might have problems, he may have whatever, but you just know that, man, this is a good guy. When he makes decisions, when he does things, you just know he's always wanting to do the right thing, right? You know people like that. And so this is the kind of guy that Joseph was. Joseph was just sincerely, he was a good guy, and he did not want to disgrace her, right? So he decided to kind of dissolve the engagement secretly and privately. But he didn't realize that the lowest moment, his lowest moment, would be a life-changing moment for the better. He had no idea. Think about it. He's devastated. But look at Matthew chapter number 1, the first part of verse number 20. It says this. It says, but while he thought about these things. Listen, he was contemplating all of these things. Do I have her stoned? You know, what do I do? Do I just walk away? Am I going to need to move? Am I going to need to leave town? You know, what is this going to do to her family? I've gotten really close to them. All these things are going through his head. And here he is, verse number 20. It says, but while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, for your wife. Don't be afraid, really. But I want you to notice what Joseph, I want you to notice what he did, and I want you to notice what he didn't do. Joseph didn't argue with God like you and I would. Hold on, wait a minute, God. I don't really think this is fair. He didn't ask for a second sign like most of us would. Well, Lord, I know that you said that and you sent this angel to tell me this. However, I'm really going to need a little bit more. So could you give me a second sign so that I know that you're sure about what you're saying, the decisions that you're making right now, because this really doesn't make any sense. Joseph didn't do that. He didn't ask for any clarifying details. Nothing. That's crazy. Look at verse 24. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, watch this, did as the angel of the Lord commanded. Just that simple. I want you to remember this. You don't have to understand completely to obey immediately. You don't have to understand completely to obey immediately. You don't. You may think you do, but you don't. You don't have to know all the ins and outs. Think about all the details that Joseph didn't know. Where will we go? We're not ready for a child. Right? We're too young. How do you raise a Messiah anyway? I don't even know that we can get raising a regular child right, much less the Son of God. Talk about pressure. You do not want to mess that up, right? You know, you can mess up a regular kid, but the Messiah, you don't want to mess that up. You know, that's why people have multiple kids, because the first one, you don't know. Maybe, you know, you might mess that one up and get a little bit better, maybe with the second one, you know. My mom, it took her 4 times to get it right. Those 3 other boys she had, I just, whew. But think about all the stuff that he didn't know. What if we mess this up? He didn't know that they were going to have to travel 100 miles with a pregnant wife through difficult weather situations. Right? He didn't know that they were going to make a decree to kill all the children under 2. He didn't know they were going to have to live on the run. He didn't know the guilt that he was going to have to live with after knowing all those hundreds of children had been killed and his had been spared. There's a lot of stuff that Joseph didn't know. Right? And without knowing any of the details, Joseph simply said yes. He just simply obeyed what God said to do. Now, let's apply this to you. Let's apply this to me. What is God prompting you to do? What is the thing that God is prompting you to say or to give? What's the thing God's prompting you to do? Maybe it's to break off a relationship that you've invested a lot into at this point, because you know this is not right for your life. Maybe it's God telling you to serve, but you're in a place where you kind of already feel overwhelmed and you got a lot going on already. You're like, man, I just don't know if I can add one more thing to my plate. Maybe it's God prompting you and asking you and telling you, hey, it's time to give. It's time to start giving to the kingdom of God. Because here's what I know. I know that if God don't own your wallet, he don't own your heart. That's the reason why God tells you, give that 10% off the top. You know why? Because you give to everything else that owns your heart. That's what you give to. Whatever owns your heart is what you give to. God wants to own your heart. So he says, if I can get you to give, then I'll have your heart. So maybe it's God has been prompting you to give the way that he has already commanded you to give. Maybe it's to forgive somebody of something that seems unforgivable. Maybe that's what he's prompting you to do. What's God prompting you to do? What is God asking you to do that you don't know the details of? God, if I begin to give like this, I don't know if I'm going to be able to pay my bills. Why? Because I have built my life into a situation to where I'm living beyond my means. So I literally can't give because I have not handled my finances well. Because God says, give, and if you'll handle your finances, you'll be able to give. So now, God, I'm in a mess. And so now I'm at a place to where I really want to give, but I can't give because of the previous decisions that I've made in my life. And so, you know, Lord, I really want to. What happens if God says give anyway? Well, Lord, you know I can't do that because, you know, if I do that, then what? Then you'll be doing the thing that God said do, and then God will begin to work in your finances and bless them. Ask me how I know. I tell people all the time, I'll give you a 90-day money-back guarantee. You tithe 10% of what you bring into your household. Do it for 90 days. Watch what happens. And if God does not do something in your finances, I promise you, you can come to our office and say, I did this for 90 days. I gave 10%. God ain't done nothing in my finances. I want my money back. You know what we'll tell you? Here you go. We'll go look up everything you gave, and we'll give it right back to you. You know why we'll do that? Because we know how God works. I just know. I trust him wholeheartedly. Maybe God's wanting you to talk to somebody. I can't talk to somebody. How am I going to talk to someone? What am I going to tell somebody? How can I talk to somebody about Jesus? Well, God's told us to, number one. You never know what could happen through one single moment of obedience. I've never told anybody about Jesus before. Well, then you don't know how it feels to do it then, do you? Right. Try it. You'll be amazed at what takes place. I just don't know all the details. You don't have to know all the details. You don't have to understand completely to obey immediately. And listen, obedience is our responsibility, but the outcome is God's responsibility. If it doesn't turn out well, that's on God. That's not on me. Right? If I step out on faith and I do the thing that I know God is telling me to do and it don't work out, that's not on me. That's on him. And here's what I know about God. God is such a man, a God of his word. God's not going to mess up his reputation over you. You hear me? God is not going to mess up his reputation over you. He's just not. Obedience is our responsibility. The outcome is God's responsibility. Listen to me. I want you to hear me for just a second. After being saved, I've been saved for 27 years. After being saved for 27 years, after teaching the Bible for 25 years, after being in church leadership for 17 years, and after pastoring now for almost 5 years, here's the problem that I see with most Christians in the churches today. Are you ready? We are educated way beyond our level of obedience. We know way more than we do. Listen to me. I need you to get this. I need you to get this. Because this is churches all over America, but especially churches here in the Bible Belt. There's probably any week of the day or any day of the week that you could probably call around. There's enough churches. I forget how many is here in Greenwood, but it's nearly 300 churches. I think it's like 200 and something churches just right here in Greenwood. In Greenwood! I promise you, if you call around long enough, you can find you a Bible study on any given day of the week. You can go somewhere, right? You can find one somewhere. Some church somewhere, they're having one. Promise. Call around, find out. Go to it, have fun. Okay? You might could even find one during the day and one during the evening. Let me explain something to you. I absolutely, wholeheartedly believe that we need to spend time in the Scriptures. The problem is you need to do it at home. And then you need to apply what you're reading to your life. We are way more educated about the Bible than we are doing what the Bible says to do. We don't need to know more. Listen to me. This is going to get you. We need to do more with what we already know. Listen to me. Listen. It's going to get better. We don't need more Bible classes. What we need is more groups that are gathering together where people are learning to apply what they already know. Learning to love one another. Learning humility. Learning unity. Learning to pray for one another. Learning to encourage one another. Learning to be kind to one another. Learning to give grace to one another. But you don't do it! And you want to sit around, oh, I got this new Bible study. Oh, I went and bought this new Bible study. Oh, I'm online on this new Bible study. Oh, I got this new Bible app. Oh, I got this new Bible stuff. Oh, I'm reading this chapter. Oh, I'm reading this book. Oh, I'm reading the Bible through from cover to cover. Bless God, that's great. What are you applying to your life? How is it changing your life? It's not. Because your life does not line up with what the Scripture says. Stop telling me we need another Bible class because we don't. We need to align our life with what the Scriptures say and what we already know about Scripture. You can't even love one another. Why do you want to learn about the seven churches in Revelations? You don't need to know about the seven churches. You need to learn how to love one another. You need to learn humility. Quit acting like you know more than everybody else. Amen, right there. You need to learn some unity. Come together. Be able to agree. You need to learn how to pray for other people. Oh. But I just want what I want. I know it. We all do. Learn to pray for somebody. We had people come up here all over the altar today. You know what hurt my feelings more than anything? That I didn't see people get up and come down and pray with them. That's why me and my wife sat right there and we didn't move. Because I wanted to see who's going to come down and pray with them. But we'll sit back over in our chair and go, bless God, I don't know if I like this song or not. Don't have nothing to do with you. We're not worshiping you. We're worshiping Him. So we're going to sing songs that worship Him, not you. It's not about you. Worship time is not for you. We're not worshiping you. We're worshiping Him. So I'm sorry if we don't cater what you want in worship. Because it's not about you. Matter of fact, it's not about me. It's not even about our worship team. Aren't you glad we listened to that the other day? I am too. It's not about you. You have a preference for some different kind of worship, that's fine. Go find it. We're not changing. If you don't like that, find someplace else. We are going to worship God. And we're going to sing songs that are going to give Him praise. We are going to speak to Him in our songs. That's what we're going to do. It's too loud. Bless God, if we turn it down, somebody's going to say, it ain't loud enough. Nobody is going to be happy with everything you do. Matter of fact, nobody's going to be happy with most stuff you do. Somewhere along the line, you've got to decide to obey God. Listen, I'm not saying stop studying your Bible. You need to study your Bible. I'm not saying that we don't need to gather together and have more Bible studies. But what I am saying is that when we do gather, we need to be more about applying one verse rather than reading 20 verses. Are you listening to me? It is more important to take this much scripture and figure out how to apply it to your life than it is to take this much scripture and never apply nothing to your life. You are wasting your time and God's time. Quit. Because here's what you're doing. The more you read and the more you study and the more you don't apply, the more you are hardening your heart to the Holy Spirit. And God is not going to be able to do anything to your life or with your life, because you're just getting harder and harder and harder. You're getting more stubborn. You're getting more prideful, because you got all this knowledge that you're getting built up in your head and you think you know something. Nope. You know what you need to do? You need to take one verse. You need to apply it. You know what it is? Love one another. You know, there's another verse. You know what it says? To be humble one to another. Learn that verse. Figure that out. Apply that to your life. You get those two things down, then we'll start learning some more stuff. That man goes right there. Learn how to give grace to people. Ain't going to charge you nothing for that. That's free. Joseph didn't have all the details, but he did what the angel of the Lord told him to do anyway. Look back at verse number 20. Chapter number 1. Verse number 20. The last part of that verse says, "Do not be afraid to take Mary to be your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost." Is of the Holy Ghost. Verse 21, "And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." Now listen, the Bible just said that this child will be conceived by the Holy Spirit, not you, Joseph. Is that important? Does that matter? You better believe it does. Because if Jesus is conceived by an earthly father, then Jesus has no power to forgive sin. Because Jesus has a sin nature that is inherited by his father. Because his father is holy and heavenly, he did not inherit the same sin nature that you and I inherit. Are you listening? If he's born by an earthly father, he cannot save people from their sin. It's very important that we understand there's a virgin birth. It's absolutely imperative. If there's not, we might as well all go home today. Joseph certainly faced opposition for his obedience. I mean, you need to not think that you're not going to face opposition when you choose to obey God. You're going to. It's just that simple. When you choose to follow God in obedience, you are going to face opposition. Every single significant faith-filled act that I have ever done in obedience, I have always faced opposition. When I decided to give my life to Jesus, I faced opposition. I faced opposition to faith. Not only did I face it from other people, I faced it from my own self. I decided to give my life to Jesus, and then I had conflict with my own self for the next year. Right? For years, I was like, man, that, you know, that was that really? Did I do? You know, I worried about my salvation, worried about if I was eternally secure, worried about if I was losing it. I mean, it was all that. Had no idea. Right? I felt opposition from outside of me, from other people, because now I'm trying to live a different life, a life that they don't really want me to live. When I made the decision to marry Miss Kim and we decided to get married, we faced opposition. More than anything, we faced the opposition of fear, because we've done this before. Right? How's this going to turn out? It's going to be just like the last one. Right? Some of you face that. Well, I don't really know if I ought to get married because I've been married before. That didn't turn out too good, so what makes me think the second one's going to come, or the third one, or the fourth one, or the fifth one? Right? Opposition of fear. When I decided and we decided to follow God two states away, we faced the opposition of family. Guess what family didn't want her to do? Move. That's exactly right. And they sure didn't like the guy that was asking her to move. Whew. That was a rough few years. But we did it because God told us to. And it's been good. We have a better relationship with those kids now than what we ever would have had we not left. When we decided to go into full-time ministry, there was opposition. There was opposition of finances. This doesn't look good. Like, we can't do this. God said, do it. We said, okay, I can't figure this out on a calculator, but here we go. Guess what? God provided. We decided to start New Journey Church. Right? We came here. It was coming to Hyde Park. And man, we came in. We sat down. The pastor left, and we sat, and we talked, and we were going to start New Journey Church somewhere. It didn't matter to us where we were going to start it. We were going to start it somewhere. So we sat down with these wonderful people in the room, and they said, what's your vision, and where are you going, and what are you doing? And we said, here's our vision. This is what we believe God wants us to do. And unbelievably, they all said, man, hey, that's awesome. Let's do it here. And so we did. And so we started New Journey Church. And the whole time, the opposition of failure. What if we fail? What if we do this? What if we do this and we change all this stuff and we go this direction? And what if this thing falls off the side of the hill and it goes bankrupt? And what if we hurt people? And what if it never goes and does what God wants it to do? What if we're the cause of that? Boy, Satan had set up in my brain and in my heart at night trying to cultivate fear of failure. And then we decided that New Journey Church would be different. It'd be different than most churches. And that we would learn to love people like Jesus loved people. That sounds real good, and that's a good amen moment. But then we had opposition of friends. People that we love, people that we care about. And we faced opposition. And people had different ideas. They didn't want to go that way. There will always be opposition when you choose obedience to God. But I will tell you this, most of the opposition you're going to face will be internal. You'll face more opposition from yourself than you do somebody else. But listen, don't worry when you face opposition. You need to worry when you don't. If you're not facing opposition, you're probably not living for God. Because you're living in a world that don't like God. Are you listening to me? You don't need to worry when you're facing opposition. You need to worry when you're not. Obedience is difficult. Somebody say that with me. Obedience is difficult. Say it again. Obedience is difficult. It's going to cost you something. You need to get that. It's going to cost you something. Maybe it's going against the grain of who you are. But obedience is better. Well, this is who I am. Mm-mm. Obedience is better. I don't care who you are. Learn to obey Him. Well, that Bible don't line up with what I think. I don't care what you think. Do what the Bible says, be obedient, God will bless it. Right? It's just that simple. I don't care what it is. It doesn't matter what it is. But you have no idea what God can do through one moment of obedience. You have no clue. Just through one moment of obedience. Your life is not measured in time. It's measured in moments. Stand with me all over this place. So what about you? What will you remember about this moment? What will you remember about this moment right here, right now? Every head bowed, every eye closed for just a second. What will you remember about this moment? Or maybe what will you remember about the next moment that God prompts you to say something or to do something or to give something? What will you remember about that moment? Will you remember saying yes? Or will you remember saying no and living with a regret? Maybe it's confessing a sin. Maybe that's the next thing that he's asking you to do. You don't have to confess it to me. Confess it to him. Maybe you need to apologize to somebody. Maybe you need to forgive somebody. Maybe you need to go grab somebody and pray with them because you know they're going through a tough time and you just want to love on them because God says, love one another. Maybe you need to witness to somebody. Maybe God's been spurring you and trying to get you to witness to somebody, and you've been telling God, no, I don't know how to do that. I'm not sure about that. And you get nervous every time you get around him because you know God wants you to say something, but you hadn't said anything yet. Maybe it's that. Maybe it's giving that over to God and saying, you know what, God, I'm just going to say something. Maybe it's inviting that person to church. Listen, you don't have to understand completely to obey immediately. Just obey. Just do what God says do. It's that simple. I know that's way easier said than done. But we as Christians are way overeducated. We know a lot. We just don't do a lot. And if we had begun to do what we know, it would absolutely turn this world upside down. You have no idea what God can do through one moment of obedience. Father God, we love you. I'm so thankful that you love us. God, I pray that today we would not be able to shake this thought that you gave us today. God, I pray that when we go to sleep tonight, we would think about it. God, I pray that when we get up tomorrow, we would think about it. God, I pray that we would begin to say yes to the Holy Spirit when he's dealing with our life. When you say to do something, God, I pray that we would do it. God, when you say to say something, I pray that we would say it. God, when you say to give something, I pray that we would give it. God, I pray that you'd help us to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Help us to listen to you speaking in our hearts, prompting us to say things, do things, give things. God, help us to love one another, to encourage one another. And Lord, I pray that this week, maybe for the first time in a long time, we would look at our relationship with you different, and we would decide that we want to be obedient, really want to be obedient. Lord, I know we're not going to always make it right and do the right thing. Lord, I know that we're not always going to be perfect. But God, I pray that today we would begin to look at our relationship with you different. And that we would start the process of trying to say yes to you instead of no to you. Lord, we love you and we thank you. I pray you'd be with us as we go throughout our day. Help us to make good decisions and help us to love our family and those that are a part of our faith family. Help us to love everybody we meet, to care about them. Lord, we love you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. If it's been good to be in the house of the Lord, somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Listen, real quick, if this is your first time, man, we would love to meet you right back there. We'd love to encourage you. I'd love to put a face with a name and say thank you personally for being here. And then also, real quick, if you are interested in helping us do a build out, if you can swing a hammer, if you can run power tools, if you can sweep, if you can do whatever it is, we want to have a quick meeting right down front. And all we're trying to do is just find out who's available, when you're available, and what you would like to do, when we could start, what days we could do it on, whether it's daytime, evening time, weekends, those kind of things. We're just trying to kind of get a really quick gauge on that. God bless you, church. Have a great day. Have a great week.